Hey guys, welcome to Neon City.
Sorry.
Hey guys, welcome to Neon City Gaming, another episode of one of my new favorite things that we're doing. We have our contentious opinions. This is going to be another Hills to Die On, and it's my turn this time. And I thought it would be timely if I share with you a very, very controversial opinion I have. And if you don't see me after this, it's because I was mobbed by an angry horde of Halo fanboys. Because I think that Halo TV series is actually okay! Yeah, okay, so I know this is right now, we don't have that many commenters on our videos, but I guarantee you right now there's at least everyone who's watching this is like, oh man, I don't care what he has to say, I'm just gonna leave a comment, unlike the video, and I'm skipping out of here. But wait, please give me a chance, hear me out. First of all, I want to say that I am a fan of the Halo lore and Halo universe. I read the Nylund books, I read
allegedly
Deeds. Allegedly. I loved the novels. Those were some just easy to digest, fun sci-fi, you know, for that time around when the games are coming out, things of that nature. I've played a ton of the games. I've lassoed some of them. I still play Infinite. Dark Frost, how are you into the series?
I'm a filthy casual. I have played Halo 2. I've played ODST. Shame. And I think multiplayer on 3. That's all I play. Or not 3. Which one came out after Reach? Whichever one that one was. They had the cool like knife effects when you went to go melee someone. It would like go into an animation and stab them.
So Reach is the one that had the was the first one that had the assassinations.
Okay, then maybe it was Reach. But it was one of those I played the multiplayer. And then of course Infinite. And that's pretty much all my Halo knowledge.
So as someone who's pretty casual, what do you know about John Halo? What do you know about the Master Chief or the lore in a very truncated edition? Please expound your knowledge of the series.
He's a big dude who is like a clone, or not a clone, but like a special. Like, did you ever see the movie Soldier back in the day, where like they grow soldiers into bats or whatever?
You're on the right track. Okay.
Okay, so it's like that. And then they give him this, so he's like his own like species of human kind of thing, like a super soldier. And then they give him like this special armor, and they all have to have like some kind of AI to help them function, as far as I know. And then they're attacking the aliens known as the Flood or something like that. The Covenant.
Okay.
That's pretty much as I know.
Beautiful. Perfect.
Oh, and a red versus blue.
Let me tell you, you are the target audience for the show. Now, do I think that the 99% of other people who have very, very real and valid constructive opinions and criticisms about the show, do I think they're wrong? Absolutely not. They just want something specific from the show that show does not provide, nor does it address. As much as, and I'm there with a lot of you, as much as I would enjoy to have a Halo show that was made specifically for me, that specific in the lore, hard sci-fi fan, I would love it. But this isn't that. This is something completely different. I know it was very contentious when the show was first announced. The showrunners were saying, hey, we're trying to make Halo accessible for everyone. So you, having a cursory knowledge of Halo and the Master Chief, and he's fighting a group of aliens called the Covenant, the Flood is later, and it takes place on this giant ring called Halo. That's pretty much all you know.
Yeah.
So that would be perfect for you. Now, for the rest of us, they put a big asterisk, a huge caveat at the beginning of the show. This is something called the Silver Timeline. So the Silver Timeline,
for the silver screen,
is kind of like a blank check they write themselves, a get out of jail free card for any kind of lore breakage or anything like that. And there's plenty.
So Marvel's like World 1721 or whatever.
Yeah, it's the Marvel's multiverse. This is a new silver timeline. They're going to use some of the characters, the events. They're going to change and tweak some things. This could be an entire episode dedicated to what is different about Silver Timeline, or what I don't like because they changed this thing. That's not what this episode is about. I say that the Paramount Halo TV series is good TV because I watched it with someone who has no idea what even Halo is. And that was my wife. And she loved it. Because she didn't have to worry about all the baggage that fans like me and some of the others bring with it to this TV show. It was just, it is good sci-fi. Now, I'm going to get this out of the way right now and address this. Quan's whole storyline just could have been, we could have lost that. Quan is a character.
Okay, I was about to say, for those of us who've never seen this show, who was Quan?
There is a character who is she serves one critical point very early on in the first episode, and that is to get John 117, the Master Chief,
naked.
No. That's another original character that we will get to later. Yeah, I don't know. Something about original female characters in the show getting John to take off articles of clothing is just... That's just happens. No, it's a character that serves a critical purpose in the first episode for Silver Timeline's narrative. Who's original, added to the show. And after that, she's pretty much just completely divorced from the entire series. I think I know where they're going with her. I think they're trying to roll up and change exactly what the Forerunners were or what the Reclaimers are. But that's neither here nor there.
So what you're saying is, pretty much what I'm gathering about the Halo show, is it's Final Fantasy Remake. It You were sold a bill of lies. You were like, hey, we want to make this... Hey, guys, we're making a remake or a show or something like this based on this IP. But rather than using all the stuff that you know about and love, we're going to take it and kind of jumble it up so new people can enjoy it. Casuals, people who just know what Final Fantasy is on the surface. And not for us, you know, diehard fans who played every re-release.
Happened to me. That is what happened to 98% of all the other people who talk about this show or have opinions about this show. Because I get it. I really do. Because when they announced this Halo show, immediately in my head, I got images of that Neil Blomkamp ODST short film that they did. That was gritty and realistic. And it was... We had working warthogs. The outfits were fantastic. And even the effects for when they came out and for how the short film budget that thing had, it looked fantastic. That's what we were wanting. Instead, what they tried to do was they gave us... I'll tell you exactly what they did. And a lot of people aren't going to get this at first when I say it. They gave us a cyberpunk storyline set in Halo's universe. So, when I say cyberpunk... All right, first of all, when you're looking at the series as a whole, take away everything that you think or that you bring to the table that you associate with Halo. I know it's hard to do. But at its core, the entire television show is about humanity, like as an aspect, not humanity as a species, but what it means to be human. All right. Which is just the like paint by number central tenet to any cyberpunk story. At the beginning, you know what Spartans are. You know that the Spartans are super soldiers. They're not exactly that... vat grown or clones. They were taken as children and then medically and biologically altered, mentally altered, physically trained. They were trained by AI in the books. But they are basically child soldiers grown up into walking tanks. They have no humanity. Their humanity has been taken from them. Okay? So, the Spartans represent, at the beginning, humans turned into objects. Humans turned into tools to serve the greater human kind. On the other side, you have a character that a lot of people hate. But they work as a narrative foil to the Master Chief, and that is this character called Maquis, which is a human character who is taken as a child, just like John was, but instead of being indoctrinated into the super soldier program where you turn into an object, she is turned into a religious object by the Covenant. And her humanity is taken away from her, both because she is removed from the human culture and to something that is literally alien, and then also she's elevated above anything that would have grounded her. And then there's a good juxtaposition between Dr. Halsey. Halsey is the scientist who actually pulls the Spartan children and trains them, and then she does a lot of other stuff, which I highly suggest you watch the show. I would suggest anyone watch the show, even if you end up not liking it or agreeing with anything I say. It's perfectly fine, but give it a shot. Halsey is the one who's taken these Spartan children and stolen their humanity. She's created a Cortana. In order to create Cortana, she had to break a lot of international laws, and she had to clone herself, who her clone is fully sentient and aware, and is aware of what Halsey's about to do to her, which is liquefy her brain while she's alive to create the neural cortex for Cortana. So Halsey is the most human looking character because she's no military uniform, she wears a lab coat, she's constantly in contemplation, usually whenever she's seen, she's always well lit, she's always presented in areas that are clean and precise. So everything that she has shot in her character design is calming, soothing, and is like, this is the most human connected character. But she is the one character with the least amount of humanity. Because what she does in pursuant of knowledge and power, maybe not so much power for herself, but just that curiosity, she's monstrous. She's
well, like Goebbels. Evil.
She's a mad scientist. She is the best representation of a mad scientist, a real mad scientist I've seen in a television show in a long time or movie. But people are so focused on Master Chief took his pants off and we had to see his ass, and which is something that happens, by the way. I don't know.
I mean, they should have gave him the Carl Urban treatment in Dread, where he never took his helmet off.
I agree. However, people are focusing on what the show did differently and not focusing on why those things were done. Now, were some of them, like Quan, necessary? Absolutely not. Quan, we could have lost Quan. But if we lose Quan, we lose one of my wife's favorite characters, and that's Soren. So Soren is a Spartan who made it about halfway through training and said, you know what? This shit kind of stinks. I don't want to do this. And so he leaves. He takes most of his Mjolnir armor with him, which is that powered armor that they get.
Is that allowed? Like, is it not?
No, that is 100% not allowed.
Okay, I was going to say, I feel like that's like government issue. Like, it's like taking your M16 home with you.
No, that is 100% not allowed. No, that is a that's a little more than a smack on a wrist. But here's the thing. John 117, the Master Chief, he was going to run away with Soren. And then he decided, for whatever reason, that he wasn't going to do that. And Soren was like, all right, peace, bitch. I got it. I'm out. And then John was like, no, I can't let you do that. You know, I'm loyal to the UNSC. We're going to help people.
Uh-huh. Can't let you do that.
But the thing is, and because you've never seen this, Soren's leaving because John and a lot of the other Spartans, when they underwent augmentations, they got super strength, super fast reflexes, neural links that make them able to think in a split second. Soren got most of that and also a jacked up arm. He has an arm that's so mutilated he can't even wear like the armor on that arm. A lot of the Spartans did not do well from the augmentation process. Some of them were crippled. Their spine was jacked up and they were in a wheelchair. And
so they're not too good at this, are they? Every three they have to like throw in the garbage. Like she's like they're what's her name from Resident Evil?
So Soren, I like him, and my wife, that's her, one of her favorite characters. Because he's happy. He's sarcastic. He's snarky. He's so unlike any of the other Spartans. Because he's fulfilled. He has a wife and a child. And he makes his own decisions. And she said that. She mentioned that it's like, wow, Soren is so happy. And so Soren is a critical character because he falls into this narrative about the cost of humanity and how much we're willing to sacrifice. Because he wasn't willing to sacrifice his humanity to stick with the Spartan 2 program, he left, and he is one of the few fulfilled characters in the show. Until John shows up and offloads Quan on him, and he has to deal with that whole thing. But I really like him. My wife's favorite character, Kai. Kai is one of the Spartans. She is the best thing about the show, in my opinion. And she highlights what I think is the main complaint about the show. If they had made Kai the main character, the show would work. The only reason the show doesn't work is because they want to use John 117. And from a marketing view, from a we want this Halo show to sell, I understand wanting to use the Master Chief, because why would you not use Sonic the Hedgehog in the Sonic the Hedgehog movie, right? He's the main poster board child. So I understand executives wanting to use John. The problem is John has so much lore and so many storylines that are locked in and all the games that you have to dance around him. And if you do one thing wrong, like taking your helmet off in the first episode, the whole thing falls apart. If they had made Kai the main character, because all of the narrative discovering humanity beats that Master Chief goes through, Kai does too. It's so mirrored that I'm kind of wondering if the show wasn't originally written for Kai or a character that would become Kai, and they put just Master Chief front and center just to sell the show. Because when he starts discovering his humanity, Kai starts discovering her humanity, and that's juxtaposed against the military-industrial complex that is the UNSC. And the admirals that are in fighting, and then also the two other Spartans, Vanek and Riz, who are charming in their own right, especially Vanek. There's something about Vanek. He's like, and maybe I'm just the one getting this vibe, but he gives me like big teddy bear that would also maul you to death vibes.
Let me play the devil's advocate, I guess, here.
Absolutely. Absolutely hit me.
Or rather,
everyone else's. I guess.
So, okay. I get trying to forgive it for being like, okay, they're trying to tell a story of humanity, blah, blah, blah. That's why he takes his helmet off, so you can see the emotions in his face. I feel like it'd probably be more hard-hitting to show his humanity, where he is pretty much stuck in the suit for the most part. And then, you know, like back to your reference of RoboCop earlier, you know, finding out where the man ends and the machine begins kind of thing. And that, you know, you're a weapon of war. So pretty much, you know, like Batman, I would assume he's more comfortable in the armor than just being like, hey guys, I'm the star of the show. Like where he's more like Sylvester Stallone, you know, in Dread rather than in
Carl. Am the Lord!
Which I have a soft spot for that movie because I love Stallone, and like I was a kid at the time when that came out, but it's definitely not as good as Carl Urban's version. But that said, like, what they could have done is they could have had them both be the main characters, and then to keep that thing where they could have had the girl that you mentioned, she's out of armor, so she could have been the actual human face to.
That's what I'm saying.
And then Master Chief could have kept his suit on, you know, or at least at the very least, he shouldn't have taken it off in the first episode of all the show. Like, save it like The Mandalorian did for like the second to last episode. He's about to die, so he's taking his helmet off. I feel, granted, I haven't seen the show, so I have no reason why he would take his helmet off in the middle of a live fire exercise or combat thing, you know.
He doesn't take his helmet off. In combat.
Like, okay, I heard was in the middle of combat, and he's like, don't worry, guys, come with me, I got you.
Now, later on in the series, he has his helmet off way too much. Way, 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 I don't know. Like, he has his helmet off so much that I kind of want to know if that helmet you can actually see out of. In order to enjoy the Halo television series as a fan of Halo, going into it, you have to, they're asking you to leave so much at the baggage claim and just enjoy your trip. Whereas people coming into it who don't have all that are free to enjoy some of the, you know, decent writing and some of the good narrative devices and literary devices that they're using. Again, the entire show is about what you're willing to sacrifice, how much of your humanity are you willing to sacrifice to win. Literally, in the last couple of episodes, Cortana is tasked with literally taking free will away from the Master Chief and basically puppeteering him like a meat puppet in tank armor. And that happens. But in order to do that, he has to give up what little humanity, or the humanity that he has, in order to become that weapon. And that's narratively what it's building up to. All of the other criticisms about the show are completely valid. I'm saying that those people are so focused on that that they're missing out on John slowly building his humanity and gaining his humanity and finding out what it is to fight for. Just so in the last few moments of the entire show, all of the humanity that he has gained and holds precious, he sacrifices to give his humanity over completely to Cortana to turn him into a weapon to win the war.
Yas, Queen.
Now, narratively, I think that's really cool. Should that have been John 117? That's the problem people have with the show, is they took a character, they took a role that would have been beautiful had they used literally any other Spartan, and they gave it to John, and it doesn't work because people have this, John wouldn't do that, John, that's not how John acts, and they're right from established lore in the novels and the games.
Yeah, now, it's like Luke Skywalker in the sequels compared to all the other movies.
Right. Right. Like, there's an established canon, there's an established way that Luke Skywalker acts, so to have him act completely counter to all that, and to completely counter to all the character development he's had, just throw that out the window, that makes sense. But those are supposed to take place in a singular timeline. The Silver Timeline, John 117, is not Master Chief from the books or the game. Now, I know people are going to feel like that's just a contrived reason to let them do whatever they want to do with the lore and things of that nature. But they're narrative criticisms. But let's talk about Master Chiefs. Okay. The number one thing that everyone lost their shit over was the sex scene. So the one thing, there are a lot of things I would see Master Chief doing. Getting jiggy with it is not one of them. But people need to look at the narrative through line of Maquis being a human without humanity, John being a human without humanity, both of them through different means finding their humanity, and then meeting each other at this cross-section where they both basically get to celebrate their newfound humanity from two completely different vectors.
By doing the oldest thing humanity does.
By doing the most human, basic thing. Now, was it well filmed or choreographed or anything like that? I don't know. I'm not here to talk about that. From a narrative, literary perspective, I can see that, and for a brief moment, it was beautiful. It is her finding her humanity and finding out what it means to be human, him finding his humanity and finding out what it means to be human, and then them coming to that point together. And it's,
well, they could have shared a meal or something like that.
Well, that,
you know, like, there's a lot of humanity things that make, you know, humanity worth, you know, celebrating. And don't get me wrong, sex is great. I'm not against sex. Sex is fine, and especially in a lot of things. I grew up in the 90s, 80s, and 90s anime. Okay, it was everywhere. That said, you don't always have to just throw it in just for the sake of it.
Kind no,
of
like, okay, but here's the thing.
You know.
All right, hey, between the first.
But I do forgive that more than the helmet. He should have had sex with his helmet on.
One of us has a literary degree, all right? We just
agree.
Oh,
we're going to start throwing out credentials, huh? Is that, yeah, is going to invalidate my entire argument?
Right. 6 years of college says I get to invalidate everything you say. No, that's not what I'm trying to do. That's not what I'm trying to do at all.
I don't see no diploma on that wall.
So, no, here's what I'm trying to say is the sex scene is a culmination of both of their character arcs from tools, objects, to humans.
No, I get
hold
your
on,
argument.
Let me finish.
I'm going to let you finish.
From objects to finding their humanity and being human and celebrating that, here's why it doesn't work the way they wanted it to. It doesn't feel earned. And it's the pacing of the episodes.
There How far into the show is it?
It's one of the later episodes, like one of the last episodes. It's either the second to last
okay,
episode.
Okay, so it's not like the helmet where they just like spring it on you in episode three kind of thing.
So in, even though it's at the end of the thing, it doesn't feel earned because of timing and how much space or how much time they were able to spend on it. But I think they weren't able to spend a lot of time on it because they spent so much time on Quan's storyline, which has almost no relevance to anything else that's going on.
I already forgot who he was this entire during this conversation.
Quan's a she.
I forgot who she was during this conversation. That was the one that got kidnapped, right? Or no? Yes, the Covenant kidnapped her.
No. Quan. Okay. So Quan is the daughter.
Your wife's favorite character.
No.
Okay.
No, that's Kai, who is a Spartan.
Kai with the arm, right?
No, that's Sorin.
Okay. Man, all these names are hard to keep track of. I don't know. I should have like a little cheat sheet here.
No matter how else this gets edited, we're keeping that in. that's Halo, the television series, is a story about humanity and who we are as humans and how much of our humanity we're willing to sacrifice to serve human interests as a species.
Which I do like that narrative concept. You know, I mean, that's part of the reason why I do like Ghost in the Shell or RoboCop, you know, on top of the other stuff that you love, the cool robotic shit. You know, those kind of stories are endearing and are interesting to me. It's, I mean, one, I'm not, granted, I'm a casual. Like, I play Halo for the multiplayer generally just because, you know, you're like, hey, let's play Halo. I'm like, yeah, sure, I'll pick it up, let's go. So I don't have like an attachment to the characters or the universe in like the way I would Half-Life. You know, if this was a Half-Life movie, I'd be on the other end to be like, okay, well, this is where they fucked up. I just don't have any, like, outside of that and the fact that, you know, to me, the cool part of Halo is the power armor and the weapons and the combat. I don't have any attachment to the world itself. So regardless if it's set in that universe or not with John Spartan, or not John Spartan, not Demolition Man.
Spartan! John Spartan!
John 15, what is it, 515?
Yeah, it's John 867 5309.
I hate you. I almost didn't get it.
No one's old enough to get that joke.